Hello and welcome to Louis Philippe in Pursuit of Excellence. My guest today is one of the leading bankers in the country and a true original. The Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of ICICI Bank, Chanda Kochhar. Chanda, great to see you. We have a lot of common friends and we've never had a chance to really interact. So it's really wonderful to see you.
Same here.
When I look at someone like yourself, I always like to go back in time and think, you know, how did she grow up? Where did she grow up? How did she suddenly get interested in banking? You know, all these questions keep coming up. So tell me a little bit about your growing up and your siblings and so on.
So I grew up in a simple education-oriented middle-class family in Jaipur. My father was the principal of the regional engineering college there. And we were three of us as siblings. And I think even at that point, the entire attitude in the family was that there's one son and two daughters, but there's no distinction amongst all three. And, you know, for all three of us, education was as important. Making a career was as important. So basically, it was simple, humble background, but with a lot of focus on education and independence.
So when you're growing up, was there any involvement in anything else, your early interests, you know, sports, kite flying, you know?
Yeah, actually, you know, I was very interested in dramatics. In fact, that time, those were not the days of television. It was actually All India Radio. And I used to, in fact, even participate in some of the programs there. I used to play a little bit of basketball and badminton. But yeah, these were the simple, you know, areas of interest. I think always been interested in Bollywood, and that interest continues even till now.
Were there any interest in, I mean, being dramatic and being in drama and school and so on and so forth, any interest in was taking that up as a profession?
No, not really. Even at that time, my thought actually about profession was the Indian Administrative Services. You know, being from a smaller city, that was one of the kind of professions that I really aspired for. But life took a very different turn when I lost my father at a very young age, when I was only 13. And then our entire family shifted to Mumbai. And therefore, I did my college education in Mumbai. And Mumbai being the commercial city, that's when the finance and banking and all that kind of came into play. And I did my MBA in finance and I did my interview with ICICI and I joined there.
But just to back up that moment, when you were growing up at an early stage in your career and growing up, did your parents have a strong influence as to what the girls wanted to do, what the boy wanted to do?
My parents had a strong influence to the extent that we all should seriously pursue a particular line, any line. But they never actually imposed about what each one of us should do. So interestingly, all three of us took up different lines. My sister took up medicine. My brother took up engineering. And I took up finance and banking.
That's very wise. I think everyone should go in a different line of work. You cover all professions, you know, basically. So at what point in time did you decide, yes, finance is my pursuit and I was going to get into banking?
So after I did my economics, I joined MBA, in Jamnalal Bajaj Institute. And that's where I kind of opted for finance. And I also did cost and works accountancy. So I think finance as a field got decided really almost at that time. But even then, it wasn't really supposed to be banking per se. But it so happened that as I was completing my MBA, you know, ICICI, of course, was not coming to the institute for institute placement, but they used to call, you know, maybe the topper to their office for an interview and so on. So I went and gave an interview and I got the offer and I liked the organization, so I joined. So that's how actually banking happened. And believe me, at that time, ICICI also was not a commercial bank. It was a development financial institution. So it was more of project lending and so on. And then, of course, the organization turned and transformed and I was a part of the journey.
So when you joined the bank, did you feel, okay, now I'm settled in this bank, this is where I'm going to spend my life? And did you ever think that you would end up becoming the youngest CEO?
When I joined the bank, I didn't think that I would become the CEO, but I at least knew two things. I knew that, you know, I always wanted to dream big. And the second is I always knew that you have to back up your dreams with hard work. So I just wanted to keep excelling in everything that I did. My whole approach was that whatever is the job I'm given, I want to do it better than I did the job last time. And I want to do it better than someone else had done it earlier. So, you know, with this approach of trying to excel in whatever you do, then take the next opportunity, excel in that, and keep moving on.
What was the environment like when you joined the bank at the time? Obviously, it's quite some time back, and things have dramatically changed as we moved along every 5 years, perhaps. In the industry itself, have there been major changes every 5 years?
Yeah, so I joined the bank more than 30 years ago. Lots of changes. First of all, ICICI itself has transformed and grown, you know, substantially from what it was at that point in time. So that's been a long journey, and I've been very fortunate to be part of that transformation almost at every step. Secondly, I think, you know, banking industry has changed substantially. The way of doing banking at that time was very different from what it is today. And thirdly, at that time, frankly, there were not many organizations which were so open to women, you know, having a career. But ICICI definitely was one of them. So I, in fact, joined, therefore, an organization which was always up the curve there, you know, when it came to gender neutrality.
But when you look at banking day and you see how much IT has played a big major role in it, and to the layman who always went to the bank, you know, he had a relationship with the bank manager, and you got there to either to put in money, take out money, have a coffee with him. Are those days gone?
So let me break this thing of yours. So, you know, the day of going to the bank and having a coffee with a relationship manager has not gone. Okay. But the need to go there and stand in the queue to deposit money and to take out money is definitely gone. So I think banking has changed in a way that it allows you now to do whatever you want, in whichever form you want, at whatever time you want, and through whatever channel you want. So you you have the option of doing the most mundane transactions on your own. You know, in a way, you are the boss. You don't need to really worry for standing in the queue for those 5 hours when the bank branches are open. You know, you can do your funds transfers even sitting in the car through your phone and so on and so forth. But at the same time, the branches are very much there. The relationship managers are very much there. You need your advice how to deploy your money. You need your next loan and you want to discuss it. You want to, you know, buy a property and so on. The bank branches are very much there.
So that's not going to go away, obviously, because the relationship is important. Right. Now, what makes one bank, to be with one bank, more comfortable? I mean, is it mainly the service? Is it, as I always compare it to our sport. Tennis revolves around a good serve and a good return. So if there's good service from the bank, then you want to be there. If you get good returns from the bank, you want to be there.
Yeah, indeed. You could just take that argument further itself to say that, you know, banking is about trust and relationship as well. So as long as there is this good serve and return, that builds the trust and relationship. You know, someone remains with the bank first if they trust. They trust not just the brand, but they trust the daily interaction. That is, you know, I'm getting the due or the right due from the bank. But then, of course, you know, today, in today's day and age, it's also about banks coming out with the best products ahead of time, ahead of others, because everything that technology enables you to do, if you take that and offer it to the consumer, you know, it changes for them the way they do banking and makes it more convenient and better. So I think that also makes a difference. And then, of course, you know, a multifaceted relationship also makes a difference. So if you have a bank account, you have, you know, your mortgage with the same bank, you bought an insurance with the same bank, you pay your bills through the same bank, you do your remittances on a monthly basis to your parents through the same bank. I think all that then makes the bank a part of your daily life.
Is there a major difference between banking in India, banking internationally? Are things have changed considerably over the years? Is it tougher? Is it easier?
I would say it's just getting more and more exciting. But I would say that banks in India are as much technologically ahead, if not even more, compared to global banks, because of two things. One is the Indian consumer itself is very technologically savvy. So we have seen that, you know, everything that we come out as innovations and we offer it to the consumer is just ready to absorb it and use it. So that is one there. And the second is that India gives us the opportunity actually to try all these technological innovations on a large scale. So where would you get a consumer base which is technologically savvy as well as in large numbers where you can actually try your innovation? So banking has changed substantially in these 30 years. Today, people are living their life, through mobility, through social media and through digitization. And in fact, banking has also become everything about digitization, mobility and social media. So we were the first ones to offer, you know, banking through Facebook. We were the first ones in India to offer banking through Twitter. And today, you know, all that is a part of consumers' daily life and they want to do their banking also as a matter of their daily routine rather than having to take out a few hours, go to the bank branch and complete the transactions.
So from the time you joined the bank 30 years ago and you're moving up the corporate ladder and so on, would you say that the first decade was the toughest?
I think at every point in time, that time seems to be the toughest, and the most challenging till you get on to the next stage and the next challenge and the next opportunity. So according to me, I've actually gone through various functions and various responsibilities in ICICI. And most of them actually being the new businesses that ICICI set up in the last 30 years. So each of those assignments seemed very tough when I took them over, and indeed they were. But then, you always try and take it as a challenge. And then from that challenge, you seek the opportunity. And once you actually learn it and excel in it, you feel that it was easy. So I would never say that, there was a particular period that was tough or easy. I think the moment you keep taking the next opportunity, there lies the excitement.
So as your responsibility increased and you became a senior executive in the bank and then eventually the CEO, how was your mental frame of mind adjusted to that corporate responsibility? Now you're head of an incredibly large bank. You have so many employees that you're responsible for, their lifestyles and their families and so on. How do you deal with it?
One is, I think it's really for me been a journey. I've been a part of this organization. In a way, my family always smiles and says that the name of the organization is very apt the way you think, ICICI. So I've only seen ICICI. And in a way, it's become a part of my life. So, it was never that one fine day I thought I'm sitting in that corner office in the ivory tower and suddenly it's, something. I think it's how you grow up with your family and how you just keep moving on. So I've been a part of it, seems to be a part of my life. But yes, at every step, the responsibility has increased. And I think you have to mature to take on that responsibility. And I think every movement up, every recognition is a bigger and bigger responsibility. And that's what you have to realize. But, the fact that I've seen the organization grow, I've seen the different businesses grow, I've worked with most of the people who are actually currently there in the organization, just makes me feel that it's just been one long journey.
You've known to sort of accept the stress of everyone in this bank. I mean, does that put too much pressure on yourself? Does it relieve the pressure of the rest of the group?
My belief is that as a leader, it is your responsibility to take most of the stress so that you actually empower your team to keep working and to keep focusing on what needs to be delivered. So I think taking of stress comes as a responsibility of the job that as a leader. But how do I handle stress? I think the issue is that Do you allow the stress to overtake you, or do you overcome the stress? I think that is where the difference lies. So again, my belief is that you have to face the stress or the challenge head on. You have to handle the challenge. You cannot duck it. You cannot ignore it. But at the same time, you cannot allow it to mentally overtake you. You have to overtake the stress or the challenge. And that's how you keep, meeting the challenges and moving on in life.
But do you have any special sauce for this? Is something that we can kind of bottle and give it out? Because in every walk of life, people have stress, whether it's at home, whether it's in business, whether it's in normal dealing in society. There's a constant, especially in today's environment, which is kind of fast-paced, fast-moving. You don't know what's happening the next day. Is there something that you do? Do you practice yoga? Do you kind of, how do you kind of temper yourself?
No, I think I actually do not have any special sauce for it. I think it's just that you remain focused on saying that you have to handle the situation and move on. And that focus and determination probably just, allows you to keep going ahead and not get deterred. And I think it's only when you get defocused that, so many other things overtake you.
Is there any particular thing that you follow as far as being is banking a question of more males in banking, more females in banking? Should there be more females? Should there be more males? Should it be gender-based? I always think, coming from a sport, everything is based on merit, and it should always be based on merit. So, but in real life, often that doesn't happen.
No, I actually believe that, whenever someone every day comes to the workplace, he's not coming with his manhood, or she's not coming with his womanhood. I think a person is coming with his or her own personality. So you look at the person and you look at the person's capabilities, and that's what the person deserves based on his or her merit. So I think this whole thing again has to work two ways. One is the organizations have to be entirely gender neutral and merit oriented, and give people the next job or the next opportunity or the next responsibility based on his or her capability and hard work. And similarly, I think women also have to give to the job whatever it takes, rather than expecting those special privileges. So, whatever hard work it requires, how much ever travel it requires, how much ever long hours of work it requires. I think, again, the give and the take both have to be on equal terms. And you would find women doing as well or better or whatever compared to men.
Is there something that encourages more kids coming out of school and college to get into the finance sector, in the banking sector? Are there less people getting into it today than there used to be? You always said, I want to be a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. Very few people said banking, and then they went into banking, and the industry has grown to such a great extent. Is it fair to say more kids are getting into it?
Definitely more kids are getting into finance. And, finance is now encompasses everything. So it's not just banking, but it could be insurance, it could be private equity, and it could be so many other financial engineering kind of jobs as well. So people are getting in there. But we must also remember that in today's day and age of technology, actually skills are also, getting a little bit of, fudged, in the sense that someone who's worked in technology can start working in banking as well. Someone who's worked on sales can start working in banking as well, and vice versa. People who've looked at banking from a particular viewpoint can actually go and work in the payment systems, the payment banks, the technology-oriented companies. So skills are also kind of, getting a little bit mixed, because banking is not just pure banking, it's a technology play, and payment systems is not just technology, it's a value chain across the financial system.
Do we need more of them to come in? Is the industry going to be growing even more, so that when you encourage university students to look at sectors, that they don't necessarily look only at medicine or law?
Yes, the sector is going to grow substantially, and it's not just banking. I would say the entire financial sector will grow substantially, because you have banking to start with, but then you have so much of technology play on banking, and then you have the entire payment systems, and then you have the commercial banking, investment banking, private equity, and the financial engineering part of it. So there are going to be lots and lots of opportunities in this entire financial services field. But I would also say that skills are also fungible in today's day and age, because banking is, again, not just pure transaction banking. People who've looked at technology can be very good bankers. People who've been bankers can be very good technology players. And, you know, sales is as much a part of banking as a service. So skills will get fungible and the opportunities will also increase.
But as you look at banking, obviously everything is a business. And when women get into business, is it something that is more predominant today? There are a lot more entrepreneurial looks at women in business because they're starting their own businesses. I remember when we started playing tennis, my mother really went into business at the time, which was sort of unheard of during the 60s or late 50s, early 60s. And then, you know, ended up literally paying for our tennis to be able to do something in the sport, you know, and to be healthy and so on. But that's much more opportunistic today. And I think a lot more women are getting into private businesses.
Yes, a lot more women are actually, first of all, taking up careers. And within that, getting also into private businesses. That's because the enabling environment has also kind of, you know, improved. So you have small opportunities that women can cater to, niche opportunities that they can cater to. You have more flexibility around, you know, how much you want to do and therefore, you know, how much you want to deliver. So I think overall, there is just more participation of women in the economic sector than what it was even when, say, I started my career.
But is it something that we would want to encourage even more from a banking standpoint, where loans are easily more accessible and the ability for them to start a business and be able to sustain their business?
So I think banking does not really, again, distinguish between males and females. So in that sense, I think the processes and the availability of money, etc., is as simple or as difficult or as much available for both the genders. But overall, I would say that while India has, of course, made a big journey forward in the last many years with regard to women participation, but there is still much more that we can do as far as women participation in the whole economic sector is concerned.
Okay, so leaving banking aside for the moment and coming to family, you have two children, Arjun and Aarti, and first of all, how do you manage to spend time with them?
Well, I think, we all kind of make sure that we manage time with each other. So, whenever people say that, how do you manage it all? I don't think the entire credit goes only to me. I think credit goes to my family as well, my husband and children, who also then make sure that we all work in a way that we all find time with each other. I think why I've been able to do this is that, one, I always believed and wanted to do it. So, and then having believed that I want to live a full life, I want a career, I want a family life, I recognize that it's hard work. You'd probably land up doing 48 hours of work in 24 hours. I recognize that it means time management, prioritization, focus, and so on and so forth. But once you put all that in place, and once you have your family members also not just cooperating, in my view, cooperating is a very small word, but actually participating, in that way of life, I think it gets done. So, on a daily basis, you're choosing between whether at that moment you are at office or at home. But on an overall basis, you kind of make sure that you've led a nice family life and you've maintained your career.
Holidays? Where do you like to go on holidays with the family?
So wherever we get time or wherever, the logistics works out. But we do make sure that we take, at least one or, two small holidays a year. But weekends are also equally important. So whenever you get time over the weekend. And I think, the biggest trick here is that you should not only wait for those long holidays, which may never happen, but even if you get the chance to go out and have a meal together, You have to relish it. Even if you get the chance to go out and see a movie together, you should relish it. And, you know, I even relish over and above this going for, you know, shopping trips with my daughter or going for my son's squash matches and, you know, spending time with him. So I think each and every of these moments are actually precious. And, you know, if you take them more as wanting to do it rather than just having to do it, I think they all become even more precious, and that's how you're able to manage it.
What do the kids think? What do they think of mom? You know, mom goes off and she runs one of the biggest banks in the country. She's looked upon as a financial icon, a guru in this country. You know, how do they address it? You know, your mom is this incredibly famous person in the country.
I think, again, to their credit, they've been very mature about it. In fact, you know, many instances that I can remember is that, you know, when it was announced that I was, you know, being appointed the CEO of the bank, my daughter was actually in the US. She was studying at that time. So from there, she wrote me a small mail. You know, the gist of the mail was that, the last 2 days I've been reading a lot about what all you have achieved, because, you know, it was all in the papers at that time about so many years of your career. But I just want to say that you never made us feel that you were doing so many things. And for us, you're still our mother, you know, who wakes us up every morning. So I think, you know, whatever you may be in your career, your role as a mother, your role as a wife, can never change and should never change. And I think, in fact, that's the privilege of a woman, that she gets the opportunity to play the role of a wife, to play the role of a daughter, a daughter-in-law, and a mother over and above pursuing her career. And I think as long as you value those roles and you play those roles the way those roles have to be played, in spite of being whatever you are in the organization, that's how you live a full life.
What do the kids like to do? What would they like to? Would they like to follow in your footsteps? Would they like to be in other sectors?
So currently, they are actually in different sectors. My daughter's done her engineering, and she's pursuing her career. She's got married recently, and both the daughter and son-in-law are going to do an MBA now. My son has just started his undergrad. He's also actually pursuing the engineering route. So you know, they are deciding clearly what they want to do. But my son also plays squash like the father, so he picked that up. So I think you know, what we believe is that children have to focus on what they want to do and do it well. But the choice of what they want to do is left to them.
A lot of awards. You've have numerous awards and accolades in the industry. One of the most powerful women in the world, Padma Bhushan, by the government of India. What do you think of being sort of kind of crowned, so to speak, with these kind of accolades and awards? Does it make you feel that you've achieved something, or does it make you strive for more?
First of all, I think I feel very humbled by all this. And second and more important thing is that every time it reminds me that I'm carrying a bigger and bigger responsibility on myself. But you know, I don't think one can ever feel that, yes, one has achieved it all. I think you have to keep striving for more, because life is a journey. And at every stage in life, you get an achievement out of what you're doing. But that's not your achievement of life. Your life is a constant learning. It's a constant set of challenges and opportunities. And therefore, it's a constant journey where you can and you should keep excelling in whatever you're doing.
So would that be sort of something that you would want to tell the next generation of kids coming out of universities and colleges who say, well, this is not happening for us, or that's not happening for us? What would be your sort of advice to them, you know, in more ways than not just work and pursuing work, but in life itself?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, the way the world is changing today, I think it's a very exciting world to be in. So for the youth of today, it's really a very exciting time. And what is required really is to focus and kind of, you know, then it doesn't matter what they choose to do, but whatever they choose to do, they should try and excel in doing whatever they're doing. So I always love this quote when it is said that excellence is not an act, but a habit. So just make it a habit to do whatever you're doing in the right manner, to the best of your capability. And I think that's what makes you move ahead and ahead in your journey.
So over the years that you've done this, especially in this sector that you've literally given your life to, was there a defining moment in your pursuit of excellence?
Again, I believe it's been a journey. So there's not a single moment that was just a defining moment, but there have been several moments that are defining. And I also actually believe that one has to learn to cherish each one of those defining moments, because at a certain stage, you may be a very young management trainee, but if you cherish the achievement that you made at that time, that's what takes you to the next step, rather than at that time thinking, oh, I will enjoy only if I become the CEO. So I remember even when I joined as a management trainee, my training period was supposed to be 12 months, as it normally always is. But for me, for the first time, my training was cut short to 8 months, and I was confirmed at the end of 8 months, and they told me that's happened for the first time. Well, as a management trainee, that was a defining moment for me. I loved it, I cherished it, I enjoyed it, and I strived to say that, yes, the next step I would do even better. So I think at every stage, there are achievements. At every stage, you should learn to enjoy them, and from there, strive the confidence and the focus of doing better the next time.
Did you, final question really, Chanda, is coming out of Jaipur, growing up in a middle-class family with two siblings and dad passing away at a young age, did you ever think that you're going to be heading up this incredible banking conglomerate and sit in the corner office and sort of oversee these many employees and literally run a portion of the banking sector?
No, I frankly won't say that, when I was a schoolgirl in Jaipur, I would have probably thought of this corner office. But as I said, that even at that time, the only thing that I was taught was that, be focused in life, try and do everything to the best of your capability. And I always thought that, I would continue to dream big, and I would continue to do things to the best of my ability. And that's how I continued on the journey. And that's how I am here today.
Chanda, thank you very much. All the very best to you and the family.
Thank you.
All the best.
Thanks.
You can also watch this episode online at louisphilippe.com.